Gut, dann fangen wir an. Also herzlich willkommen zum Chaos-Seminar. Es ist das dritte Chaos-Seminar vom Chaos Computer Club Zürich an der Uni. Wir tun da vor allem Sachen thematisieren, die wir finden, dass ein breiterer Bevölkerungskreis sie auch sollte wissen, das können politische Themen sein oder auch technische. Heute sind es mehr technische Themen. Also wir wollen zeigen, was Hacken eigentlich, zumindest in unserem Sinn, im CCC alles ist. Es wird in den Medien amix verkürzt auf ja, Angriff auf Computersystem, irgendwelche Sachen lahmlegen, Viren schreiben und so. Tatsächlich sind es aber eigentlich mehr Sachen, die im Moment unser Staat macht und weniger wir. Also wir kämpfen eigentlich gegen das an. Wenn man die Hackerethik liest, zu welchen wir uns verpflichtet sehen, dann sieht man auch, dass schon im ersten Punkt eigentlich steht, dass der Zugang zu Computern und allem, was einem zeigen kann, wie die Welt funktioniert, unbegrenzt und vollständig sein soll. Das ist einfach wirklich eine Maxime. Natürlich ist es in der Realität nie so einfach, aber wir arbeiten einfach mit Maximen. Und das gehört halt auch zu der ganzen Arbeit, die wir im CCC oder anderen Hackerkreisen in dem Sinn machen. Gehört halt auch dazu, dass man nicht einfach alles glaubt, was von oben herabkommt, sondern einfach mal selber dahinter schaut, jetzt auch hinter die Geräte und sich einfach überzeugt, dass einfach das, was behauptet wird, nicht stimmt. Also zum Beispiel dann auch bei Trojaner oder solchen Schadsoftware, die vom Bund kommt, da wird dann einfach behauptet, rechtlich machen sie das und jenes. Und ja, wir würden einfach eher mal genauer anschauen und dann zeigen, das stimmt alles nicht, ist eine Lüge. Und dann einfach öffentlich machen und dann wird das Zeug oft wieder abgeschafft. Das ist in Deutschland zum Beispiel schon wiederholt passiert. Und das werden wir auch in der Schweiz fähig zu machen, im schlimmsten Fall halt mit Unterstützung von Deutschland. Und sonst hat es eben auch Antidiskriminierungssachen drin, also das ist ein soziale Aspekt, oder? Also dass man nicht Leute nach Aussehen, Alter, Herkunft und so weiter quasi beurteilen, also nach dem, was sie machen. Und wir werden jetzt auch heute zeigen, was man das alles kann machen mit Software, Hardware oder auch Alltagsgegenständen. Und dafür haben wir auch zwei Leute da. Der Karel, er ist eigentlich nicht direkt jetzt vom CCC, er ist von einem anderen unabhängigen Projekt, das sich Twibright Labs nennt. Das kann ich euch vielleicht selber vorstellen. Und der David, der ist ganz klar vom CCC Zürich. Und ja, der Karel haben wir eingeladen, weil er einfach mal aufgefallen ist, schon vor mehreren Jahren uns, wie er da irgendwie von A bis Z einfach alles macht. Also von irgendwie Reinigungsmittel über Hardware bis hin zu Software wird einfach wirklich der totale Spagat irgendwie gemacht. Ich kann mal sagen, beim David und bei anderen Leuten ist es meistens mehr auf Software oder Hardware. Aber man kann es natürlich auch ausweiten, aber bei mir ist es wirklich zum Teil recht extrem sozusagen. Aber sonst würde jetzt mal der Karel anfangen mit dem Projekt, das er macht.
Okay.
Und falls ihr dringend Fragen habt, wo einfach, also jetzt wirklich eine Verständnisfrage, bevor er einfach weiterredet, könnt ihr die durchaus stellen. Der Plan ist, dass der Karel etwa 30 Minuten redet und der David nachher nochmal 30 Minuten. Und nachher könnte man einfach diskutieren, was man eigentlich sonst noch alles machen kann oder was sonst einfach auch alles gemacht wird. Oder auch zu diesen Projekten, die da laufen, Fragen stellen. Aber falls natürlich das Ganze schon die ganze Zeit läuft, Diskussion, dann, ja, dann dauert es dann halt bis ganz am Schluss. Und wir müssen etwa so um 9 Uhr irgendetwas, müssen wir dann vielleicht fertig sein. Aber sonst kannst du jetzt mal anfangen. Läuft bei dir es?
Ja. Soll ich diese verwenden?
Ja.
Okay. Soll ich auf Deutsch sprechen or can I speak in English? Because if it goes to podcast, people from the world maybe want to hear it. So is here anyone, gibt es jemanden, der Englisch nicht versteht?
No.
Okay. So I will speak in English. Thank you. My name is Karel Kulhavý. Where I come from, we have some kind of group of few friends which we call Twibright Labs, and our idea is basically user control technology, which is like, you know, you have free software or open source hardware, and with free software the user control is clear, and with open hardware there is a lot of discussion what actually should be open hardware or not. For example, we had a discussion with Leviathan, and there was a sociologic analysis of my project by Johan Söderberg from Göteborgs Universitet. This was a doctoral thesis, and he is talking about my concept of user control technology, which goes, you know, if you have open source hardware, it's like the sources should be open, right? But the rest is a lot of discussion, and my user control technology is the idea that the user should have a control over everything. Is listed in this work also a means that not only you should have access to resources and the sources should be open source, but also if you use some software to actually develop the product, you know, you need to make some drawings or make electric schematics. You have to make the printed boards, you know, with a special software. This software should be also open source, you know, because if the user wants to have a control, you know, some user said, okay, I want to add a small component here. And now he realizes, oh, now I have to buy a license for a proprietary software for 20,000 francs. No, it's not practically possible, right? So this is my philosophy. And in Twybright Labs, we do both software and hardware. So if you have a smartphone, you can look at the same time with me. Twybright.com is like twilight, but instead of light, you have bright, right? And we have free physical products for manufacture by the consumer and free software. And my dream is to have some kind of supermarket where you can download products, you know? You go to Coop or Migros or whatever supermarket, you need a cleaner. Okay, here you should have an alternative. You download a cleaner. Okay, but how can you download some information and turn it into a physical product? You need a process in software, you call it compilation, where you turn the sources into the program. It's automatic process in software. In hardware, you can't do it automatic, except with some things like 3D printer, right? You have factories which produce products, and you have machines which do a lot of functions. But a human is, for me, is wonderful, marvelous, unbelievable amount of functions. You know, your hands are so versatile. Your eyes can recognize objects and do all kinds of, you know, even if you're an uneducated person, you have so many possibilities. So I basically write a program for a human how to produce the product, you know, which means instructions which are simple, clear to understand step by step and don't require you to think a lot, you know. So this is my dream, and I make a lot of projects. So what I wanted to talk about first. Okay, so you may know the Lynx browser, which is a software project. It is a lightweight browser like a web browser, and it's fast and doesn't. Sorry?
It saves my life multiple times. Open chat tool. You fuck up your Unix or all configuration that you need to find out how to fix it.
So you have this browser in virtual every Linux distribution. It's like bundled and is fast and saves space, easy to install. And then I have the Piranha project, which is from the hardware part, which was, in my opinion, a very successful or famous project. Here's a quotation, old but fascinating open hardware, 10 megabit, 1.4 kilometer airlink with LEDs. So you see the device here, it's optical transmission, you know, like you have a wireless VLAN, you know, you can connect your laptop through the air with radio waves. This is the same, but it doesn't use radio waves, it uses light. Here is a lens, you know, you can see the lens, it's a very cheap loop, and it makes a red light which shines up to 1.4 kilometer, and it can have 1.4 it can have 10 megabit full duplex. So it's a very steady transmission speed. You can load it 100% in both directions and you don't notice slowing. It's different than wireless. If you load the wireless, it starts getting like stuttering, you know. This doesn't go smoothly all the way, you know. And there was, you know, about 2,000 installations worldwide. There is 153 of them are registered in this gallery. So 153 registered installations. And here you can see the pictures of the devices built by people all around the world, you know, installed on their houses. It was used by people, it was used by companies. It looks like this, you know, this is the light beam which actually can carry internet to your home. And the total length of the installed links was about 80 kilometers. And the project exists since I started developing 1998. And the first release of this version was December 2001. So it's a project which is already 13 years old. And now, today I would like to talk a lot about Distill Cooker, which is my new project. It's not released. And I have such a financing model, which is also described in this doctoral thesis, where I make a finished product and then write what properties it has and how much it costs to develop. And I ask people to contribute donations. So this is the page of the Distill Cooker. And I have 830 francs and remaining is 1700. And a lot of people already sent donations. So I would like to ask you if you can and if you want to contribute with a donation. And when the project is covered 100% with donations, then I can immediately release the result. You know, the result is like 60-page document. This is like abridged version where the technological secret is not described, is taken out. And okay, so what is this Distill Cooker? You know, what does it do? It's a combined drinking water distiller and thermostat cooker. You know, we have 0.8 billion people in the world who don't have drinking water. It is meant for layman people to build, you know. You don't need to understand anything about mechanics. You can be just an ordinary person. You can be a woman who is caring about her child in her house. And she can do it in spare time. The material cost is $15, you know. Because I'm aiming at poor people, I have to keep the material cost down. The building time is 37 minutes. This one, this machine, this electronic machine, took 70 hours to build. This is just half an hour, something over half an hour. And you can, on this Distill Cooker, you can partially use trash as a material. This is called upcycling, you know. And the rest is easy to access. I have an internet friend in Cambodia, and I ask him, you know, you have this powder, you have this powder, can you go to a store and look what they have exactly, how much it costs, you know? And he knows about the city, he knows about the land, he knows about the people who don't have the drinking water, and he knows what kind of stuff they have in their kitchen, you know? So I designed specifically for these people to be able to build it as well. It's, as I say, it's ready for release, you know? If I get the donations now, I can, at home, I can do it in half an hour, it's online, you know? The water quality is extremely high. It uses water distillation, you know. I made a heat some drinking water, you know. This is the output from Distill Cooker, you know. I can drink it because I'm a bit thirsty from the talking. And, you know, virtually almost any kind of toxic substance which you can get in drinking water is eliminated by this simple, easy-to-build device. But, you know, I said it's a thermostat cooker. What does it mean, thermostat cooker? It's a cooker which keeps the temperature stable. That means where is it written? Mm-hmm. I can't find it now. You can basically put the cooking into kitchen, go away, and forget it. And if you leave it too long, nothing happens. It doesn't burn. It doesn't. Make foam. You know, nothing. So you can basically forget it. Which I really love it at home. You know, I put cooking, go to the PC, and you know, if I forget it like half an hour, who cares? You know. There is a bank account. You know, where people can send donations. You can send by Western Union and MoneyGram and, you know, within Europe, sending the donation basically doesn't cost anything. Many people ask, for example, Leviathan, how is the safety of drinking distilled water? You know, there is this preview document, you know, PDF, 63 pages. You can view on your phone maybe if it supports. And here is the safety of drinking water somewhere. It's in the usage instructions. You have the manufacturer and operating instructions, drinking soft water safely. You know, drinking water produced by the distilled cooker is soft, has no minerals. Human body needs minerals. How much minerals do you lose by drinking distilled water? It's about 9 or 7%, you know. So there is a recommendation how to replace these minerals cheaply. You know, it means like you basically, you can eat a few nuts, you know, peanuts, you know, 22 peanuts per day, for example. Or you can eat half a banana per day, you know. So in Cambodia, bananas are very cheap, you know. So this is not a problem. You can use it already now when it's not developed yet. You have a table here where you can put what you eat, how many portions, and at the end you get this total, you know, and you can know for yourself if your calcium and magnesium intake is adequate, you know. So you can benefit from the document already now, even when it's not released yet. So what's my experience in actually this kind of development user control technology? I have 16-year experience. I have 3 scientific articles about Ronja. There are some more articles which, like, cite Ronja, you know. I have so many citations. I can show it on the web. How can I go back? Fibrite Labs, hardware, Ronja. And here is publication links, you know. So there are doctoral dissertations, there are journal articles, printed book, master thesis. You know, it's like many students love to do it like a bachelor or master thesis because it's kind of pre-cooked thesis for them. You know, they build it and describe it, they measure something, you know. And, you know, I find it cool. I find it like a contribution to education. And these people say it's an excellent way to learning. At that time it was like 26 citations. I had these 2,000 citations. Is the sound okay? How will I release it? You know, what license will it have? It will have Creative Commons CC BY. You know, share attribution, share alike. You know, and then how is it with making money? You know, if you maybe you want to make thousands of these devices and sell them and make money. You know, of course you can do it. It's like with free software. You don't have to register. You don't have to send me any fees. You don't have to ask me. You can just do it. You know, and I will be happy because I get marketing for my product. You know, if I get a lot of happy users. They say, oh, you know, I love this cooker because the water is great. You know, my children are not having diarrhea anymore. You know, I can save like tons of money on healthcare. You know, and I can do other things when I'm cooking. You know, so I would like to give this guy a donation. You know, because maybe he brings some other product which I can use. You know, so this is why I'm happy actually when people are using the product. You know. I want people to copy my product, to sell it for their own profit. And the download, as it's usual in the open source community, it will be without any registration. You don't have to pay anything, you know. You don't have to put any passwords or your name or email address. No, just normal download like it's here, you know. I will just replace this preview version where you have this technical secret is crossed out. I will just replace it with the full version. You know, you see a lot of X's because people could just derive how it works inside. I think my technical design is quite innovative, and unfortunately, I couldn't even publish any pictures because already from the outside shape of the device, you could see what is the technical secret behind it, you know? So I have tons of other products. Unfortunately, I was talking a bit too long.
Okay, you can just. Okay.
So what is the palette of products I am doing, you know? Hernani already said, is bright, is wide, a wide range, you know. It goes everything from very simple things like cleaner for like a bathroom, you know. It's called Pling, and I have some user testimonials, you know, from Cambodia, you know. It works well, Bunachut, Cambodia, you know. Or the cleaner is simply excellent, Hansgut, Zurich, Switzerland. Oh, it works well against limescale, perfect for a bathtub or a washing basin. Zurich, Switzerland, you know, is the comparison before, after, you know. People might think, oh, it's so trivial, you know, you get thousands of such instructions in the web. But for me, important is what I call productization. Means a ready-made product, you know. You go to supermarket, pay 3 francs, get it. 1 minute. I want the same online, you know. You don't have to think. You don't have to ask yourself anything. You should get very, very clear definition what it gets, what it brings for you. You know, what all you can clean, bathtubs, glasses, kitchen, countertops, whatever, you know. But you must be able to know exactly, simply, clearly, what it does, what it doesn't, you know. Okay, I need to clean something. Is it here or no? Okay, kitchen, countertop, great. Okay, product is for me. Testimonials, okay. Product is good. Okay. So what I need, you know, time, 4 minutes, okay, it's okay for me. Plastic bottle, I can get vinegar, okay, it's cheap dishwashing liquid I have at home, you know. Salt, everyone has salt funnel, I have funnel laser printer, yes, nitrocellulose, or other glue, of course, I have glue for paper. Permanent marker, has everyone scissors, dry rack, okay, I have it. Okay, I can produce the product now, you know, manufacture. You know, you print a ready-made, label, you know, and stick it on the bottle. And the label is, of course, important because it tells you, for example, you know, as I say, devil is in the details. It tells you, caution, do not mix with hypochlorite bleach and derived products. Toxic fumes may occur, you know. So it may seem simple that you pull that you put 3 liquids together. But, you know, a product in a supermarket has to have all these details, and I put them there, and this is what I call productization. It should be finished, you know, and these amateur guides in the internet, you know, I have made this bio product, you know, and this and that and this variant, you know, I have a whole forum which can you can read like for days, you know. This is what I don't like, because the user doesn't know, is it good, is it 100% finished, you know, is there anything which could have be like a hidden problem, you know, because he mixes with something and he gets chlorine and he can get health damage from this, you know. So I said, even a simple product should be made to a finished product. Or I have like, this is already empty, I used it up, is anti-aging cream, you know. Some anti-aging creams take us like 300 francs, you know. So I try to put all kinds of ingredients, you know. It has, of course, it has coenzyme Q10, and it has AHA, and it has, even I have a new version, which has peptides, you know. It's so difficult to make peptides, because I ask some chemist forum, okay, how can I make peptides? Oh, you need like a machine for 60,000 francs. Oh my God. I managed to find a way how to do peptides at home. I was like amazed, you know. I was amazed what the home technology can do. It's unbelievable. Now I have peptides there, but it's not online yet. It's like testing version, you know. Then I have like this exercise bicycle. It was too big to actually bring here. So I bring just the electronic box for it. It's this one. And it produces directly like line voltage, 230 volts, you know. It doesn't need any kind of transformers inside, you know, which I find very cool.
Sorry, just a question. I think at Revamp IT there is an installation, not?
I have it at home now.
Ah, it's not at
I need it for IT. Fitness, you know.
Ah, okay.
And there is a video, because once I kind of hack it, you know, it was a dangerous...
It's a pedal generator made from a three-phase asynchronous motor and a bicycle. And we are going to make some electric arcs with it. So, protective goggles against harmful radiation. It peaks over 1000 volts when the wires are disconnected. Let's see if we can light a candle with it. The generator gives about 2 amps DC maximum current into the...
And then there are some much bigger arcs in one place of the radio, which for me look almost like atomic bomb, you know. I would like to show you. I think it was somewhere in the air.
Oh wait, do you hear sounds?
You know, and I managed to melt steel with it, you know. The mankind had problems making fire, you know, with their own muscle power, you know, making stick or like this, like just fire, you know. How long did it take for the mankind to melt steel, you know? First they do copper, then they do iron, and then steel was such advanced. You know, I have a machine, you just sit on, and you can make smelt steel. I made balls of molten steel. I made a hole in my floor from the molten drops of metal. I find this amazing. It's like unbelievable what you can do with home technology. Now, you have this coolness factor, of course, but I did this for coolness factor because no one needs to melt steel wires at home. You know, it's dangerous. You need to have thick rubber gloves and like some special thick wires, and you need special protective measures, you know, in place. Normal person can't do it. It was just an experiment, but it's unbelievable. You know, you can do peptides, you can melt steel at home. You know, why is this possibility not used? Why is it, you know, an uneducated lady in a rural Thailand, she can produce products, she can build this steel cooker, she can sell it to other people, she can get employment from this, you know. She can do it while she is caring about her child, you know. She doesn't have to choose between employment or her child. She can do both at the same time, you know. So why is this possibility not used? You know, now I prove another time this water is not toxic. Actually, I love it. If you make what's his name? Hagenbutten is rosebud tea. It's an excellent taste if you make it from this steel cooker. And peppermint tea has also excellent taste, but normal tea doesn't have this trick. Okay, so what other, can I still speak about the products?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
What other products do I have? Then there was a product, I2C2P, if I can find it. And I was actually, today I was quite amazed how many open source stuff I have at home, you know. Is this one. It's some kind of half scientific interface where you can plug it into your PC, and here you can put some kind of thermometers, which like many thermometers at the same time, which I use, for example, in laboratory stuff like this. Because in Prague, I had to go to military, but I am pacifist, so I refuse, and then you have to go to a replacement service. And this replacement service was on the university. And they asked me, okay, we need this kind of interface. So I designed it and I asked, can I make it open source product? Yeah, no problem. You know, it's a university. They published their research, right? Why shouldn't it be open source? Okay, so I made it one Twibright Labs product. Again, you have material required. You have, you know, go to electronic part shops. Okay, I need these capacitors and resistors, you know, are the tiny parts, you know, and then printed board. How do you make printed board? You know, it's factories. This is, you can't, basically, would be very difficult to make it at home. So you have like a file, a zip file, you know. This one, i2c2p.zip. And there's a readme, which is basically like order for the factory. You know, please make me this board and these other parameters. Shape and how many layers and how big is it and what is the format of the data. This is all the data which the specialist needs to know. Normal user doesn't necessarily understand it. You know, what is solder side copper differs from Gerber hose are shown here on a polarity of drill data through plated hose. It's all technical terms. And, you know, for the Ronja project, there was a high school student in Prague. After his school, in free time on the evenings, he just sent this kind of file to a factory and orders like 100 pieces. You know. He made a very simple website where you just put your email address, how many pieces, you know. You send a payment by PayPal, whatever, it doesn't matter. And then he sends the pieces by post. And thanks to this, he could offer a 6 times lower price than if you ask the factory yourself, you know, because there's economy of scale in that. And he sold like 1,000 pieces, you know, but he was a student. He had no idea about electronics. He didn't even need to understand it, you know. All you need, find a factory, write them in email, please make me 100 pieces of this C attachment. You know, you attach this ronja.zip and readme.txt and that's all. You get it by post. You don't even have to go there, you know. So I see this as a huge potential for people. You know, he was making money out of it, you know, for free, you know, download a file and make money out of it. So I see potential for the public, you know. You know, these poor people who don't have drinking water, you know, and now I have a better drinking water than here in Zurich, you know. If these poor people, they pull this disgusting water from the slums, you know, full of like stuff floating and human feces, they put it into this, okay, they get a better water than we have here in highly developed country called Switzerland. You know, because the Swiss water has still 20% of the limit of nitrates. You know, they are carcinogenic compounds. And I was quite surprised that these nitrates, which I have in my drinking water, correspond to basically 100 grams of salami. You know, I stopped eating salami because I know there are nitrates. I'm concerned that it will increase my risk of cancer. So, but I love salami, you know, I'm just torturing myself by not eating salami because this, and I thought, oh my God, so I'm like force feeding myself with salami, with these compounds which increase the cancer risk. And, you know, I can have this for virtually for free, you know, the cost of the drinking water from this district cooker is very low. Because it's very energy efficient, you know. Distillation is normally very energy expensive process, but because it's combined, because it's reusing the heat for both processes at the same time, and you can use it on a gas cooker, anything, then you get very cheap. You know, it's cheaper than pet water in Cambodia. It's, you know, it basically pays off everywhere. So now I somehow forget what I was trying to say.
Otherwise, we could change to David.
Okay, great.
And then we can still discuss about other things.
Yes, later. And while he is talking, I will just give you some of the pieces so you can physically see them.
Yeah, good? That's fine.
Okay. Yeah. So, David, please, your stuff.
So, English,
does
right?
It works.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Yes. It works, does it?
Anyway.
So.
ZHW, hmm.
Does the sound work? Because I don't hear myself loud, but I could already, because...
Oh, no. It was switched off, okay.
Now.
Wait,
it's working.
You have to...
Is it working now? Okay, now it's working. Wonderful. Okay. Hi, folks. That's my it's one of two presentations I'm planning to hold here on this
cow seminar. Excuse me that I have this little strange voice, but I still have this cold I catched, which I still have to cure. The first part of my presentation about what we're actually doing as hackers, what do I mean when I say I'm a hacker? It's about similar stuff as my friend Carol is doing. We're just creative people. And one of the questions I had for myself was, how could I print this 3D stuff, this fancy 3D objects, these people from Walt Disney are printing with these very expensive printers, just in a small garage. How could I do it? Is it possible? Because I have these motors around, I have old metal around, and it actually evolved into an academic work. And I chose this presentation about rapid prototyping since I did it for the linguists department of this, my university. And since there are no engineers either, I figured it will have the biggest chance to be understood by also biologists and linguists, because I already tried it out on non-hack, really hardcore hackers. So, yeah. Well, the first part is, well, excuse it, it's German. The first part is, where can we use rapid prototyping? Well, when I say rapid prototyping, I just mean we are printing out three-dimensional objects from a computer model to a physical object. So where can we use that? The second part is fundamentally different ways to print out a three-dimensional object from an STL, from a three-dimensional object file into a physical object. How does that impact our development process, our development cycle? So how does it change how we develop and engineer something? Then examples of usage. So actually it was like a little bit, oh, look how great I am, how great I am, and I put some pictures of my own 3D printer into it. The next part is how far are we with 3D printing and how far can we go? And yeah, the future of 3D printing. So, usual usage of three-dimensional object printing is that think about it. You're at the dentist, and what happens nowadays? You break out your teeth, like I did with this coffee bean. So, you need a new teeth. So, nowadays, this guy there, the dentist, will go there, scan your teeth, go over to some 3D ceramics printer and print your teeth. And you have a new tooth. And ever better, the new tooth is ever more tougher than the original one, because it's made of industrial ceramics, which is 10 times stronger than usual teeth are. You can use it to have prototypes of motor blocks. Yeah, for example, figure you are working at Mercedes-Benz and you are trying to make the new ultra-fast high-speed car for the follow-up guy of Michael Schumacher. So you try out some designs and you think about how make it more faster, more power efficient, and so on. So once you've got an idea, it's the rapid prototype makes it very easy to just design it on the PC instead of just torching it together in a garage. Designing it on the PC, printing it out in metal and try out if it blows up or if it's working as you expected. And another thing is, you can easily design casings for let's say, smartphones, tablets, PCs. It's all done in hours, not days or months. So yeah, it's just faster. So that's the usual usage where you can find rapid prototyping. There are many different ways how you can do that. For example, 3D printing with many different materials. The most important is the stereolithographic method. It's the oldest of them all. It's done by using photoactive resin. Yeah, you use photoactive resin in order to print an object. You actually develop it similarly as you do develop a photograph. We have multi-jet printing. That's actually the stuff these guys over there from Maltese are using. And selective laser sintering, that's out of range, reach for me right now, doing metal printing in 3D. Actually, that's the thing the secret services are scared of, because with metal printing, which is capable of printing solid metal objects, which I'm not, which you actually cannot do, because you need a high temperature oven. You can't actually print a more than one-way handgun. So, but 3D printing is a far-fetched area, and you can print in any way with any material. And I'll show you today what I did, what you can do at home as well, with simple stuff and materials you can buy at home. But be warned. If you want to do some terrorist attacks, these materials you can use at home won't be usable to print a weapon, so forget it. You only hurt one person if you try to shoot a, shoot a bullet, and that's yourself. There actually is a group, open source gun something. They tried to build a gun and they blew. Someone was heavily wounded while they tried the prototypes out. As far as I've heard, because I had a beer with some of the guys of this development group, until now they managed to fire two bullets until the weapon blew. That's one point. The bullet still is being detected by the metal detector, so it's not usable. So panic from secret services are like, oh, maybe in 20 years it might become dangerous. Let's panic now. Okay, I drifted away. Okay, the first step, that's what we actually can hardly do at home, because you will break your back trying to transport the material required for this technique, but it's the most desirable way of printing three-dimensional objects. It's a selective laser sintering method. You use grains of some specific material, most likely something which is easy to melt with a laser, and you have two areas. Actually you have three boxes. In one box you have this ground plate you screw down. At the same time you screw the other two ones up, as the arrows indicate. You have this weld where you go over and dance it further, and then you melt together your area you want to be having stick to. You want to stick together. So you can print your object by pushing up your grains there, catching the grains which are left over there, and your object is being built together layer by layer in this middle area. So after a build cycle which uses around 1 kilogram or 10 kilogram or 20 100 kilogram, or you see where that's going, right? Of aluminium powder or any other easy to melt metal, you will get a more or less solid object. But it's actually not practical for home applications right now. Usually you print three-dimensional objects this way. No matter how you print it, it's always layer by layer. At home, you in your computer, you design your stereolithographic file, your STL files, just a collection of points. It's just like I have TerraPoint, I have TerraPoint, I have TerraPoint, I have TerraPoint, I have a mesh network, I have triangles around it, between them, and it's somewhere a three-dimensional object. Now we have a program, application, I will elaborate it further later on, which slices that into layers. And these layers are being drawn two-dimensional layer step by step, and so you build up your object. That's why every three-dimensional object which has been printed by a 3D printer looks like this one at the right upper corner. You have this step structure, these ripples on the surface of the object. You can actually identify any three-dimensionally printed object by its ripples on the surface. This layer cut ripples. And what the printer is doing, at least at our homebrew printer, in our hackerspace, is it prints even not only layers, but you can even keep apart the lines. It's printing line by line. So you have also the subtractive method, which is doing the same as an artist is doing when he's cutting away everything from a rock which isn't a sculpture. Maybe you know CNC drills. It's actually this method. You just put a CNC object into the CNC printer and just drills everything away from a base object which isn't the desired object. What it means for our development is we are not doing long calculations on a piece of paper, figuring out might it work, might it not. We just design something in a computer-aided design assistant. We export it, we feed it to our 3D printer, we test it out. Does it work? No, we should try a new one. Yes, we put it into mass production. That's what most likely has happened to our Prusa metal, because this clearly it hasn't been thought through fully. There are many misconceptions about mechanical design, so we had to break it all apart and build a new one totally from scratch. But it printed actually parts for the new one, some which are used today. But you can see, you can actually these white parts there are printed with another 3D printer of the same kind, whose parts in turn have been printed by a 3D printer. So that's a hack. So it's a self-replicating rapid prototype. For now, we only have millimeter precision. Yes. We have millimeter precision with this homebrew rapid prototypes. We have very long printing times, even with the but that's also is true with the professional ones. You have around 48 hours for very complex objects, very big objects, and you have still issues mixing materials. what we can expect for the future is way much higher precision, since we are developing with piezo controlled motorization. We're going into micrometer areas. We will have much less of a cost, because the customer base is growing, and we have also this trend into molecular printing. So maybe, maybe you have heard of this trend of miniaturization of three-dimensional objects. This little small man in the head of a needle. And there's a project which I have been pushing towards from a professor at the ETHZ over there, who's already built an electron tool microscope, and I have pushed some of his assistances to push in turn a project including an atomar printer, which uses actually all the parts of his already existing project, but instead of just electron tool microscope atoms, it picks them up and places them onto a die. So you can build together crystalline structures onto a silicon base and build up actually superconducting structures on the microchip. But yeah, that's possible already, but it's not feasible for hobby reuse, unfortunately. Yeah, if you're interested in reading stuff, that's actually from a person. From a person I actually know, and she will most likely be interested if she has time to answer your question. If you email her, just do not mention me. Yes, okay, the next point is Sun-Si project, if you're still interested. Do I have time?
Yeah, probably a little bit faster would be better, but
yeah.
Probably with a little bit less details, because people can still ask if they want.
I'm not getting tired of this presentation, because I'm actually hoping that I get one thing down for each time I hold this presentation somewhere. That's another thing I'm doing. That's less practical, it's less physical, it's less stuff you can touch. It's more, actually I forgot the Sun-C board to show around. What does Sun-C mean? Sun-C is a project group I'm into. Sun-Si is a Chinese word. It's maybe you know Sun-Si, the one who made the art of war and so on. Yeah, it's somehow related with this terminus. Sun-Si is a Chinese project group evolving around one of China's biggest chip producers, you know it. Most likely it's Allwinner. Allwinner is responsible for many of these low-cost tablets. Maybe you know the $50 Aldi tablet. And I'm in the group, which otherwise mostly consists of Chinese people and some people from Benelux states, who are trying to bring drivers for this chip platform mainline, so into the official Linux kernel. A little bit technical details. We in our group we differentiate between proprietary and unproprietary chips. So we have the chip where you can use graphics without having unfree software, and the platform where if you want to use only free software, you just have to live without graphics. The main advantage of Sunxi is it's okay. It's more than just that. It's for as simple. If you want to have for a desktop PC for $50 with 2 cores, which drains around 300 milliamperes of power, then you buy a Sunxi board, because $50 and you have a desktop system. That's, it's unbreakable. You actually, there's no way you can make it not boot anymore. And if you want to do hardware hacking, it's trivial to do. So you can have LEDs, you can have your customized hardware in no matter of time. And we have, well, it's China's biggest hardware producer, so mentioning it, it's the biggest, it's a very big community. You have mainly China, and okay, then so on. No, but we have also Benelux and so on, so it's really, it's a far-fetched community, not only China, I mean, great community. It's not only, it's great because Chinese, there are so many Chinese people. It's, I mean, with big community, it's really big community, not only in respect to China, it's really a big community also outside. Now, examples why I say it's a big community. We have the QB board 2, that's actually the thing I've started hacking on. It's, do you have 2 cores? It's $50, you have 2 cores. You have, you can power it with USB host. You have a high power graphics card. It's actually it's an 820, so it's free software. Can use the Lima. You can actually use the Lima graphics driver, which is actually totally free software. So the SD card slot driver is from me, and if and yeah. You have the QB board A80, there you have to live without graphics if you don't want to use unfree software. But it has, now listen, 8 cores. And that's, I mean, you put that as a desktop, and that's like catching you. You have the QB, and it's really easy to customize. There's a DJ board popped onto it, so you have all these audio decoder and encoder circuitry being wired out. Yeah, I'm trying, and yeah, the $50 tablet, which is actually not only this tablet, but in around 20 other devices all around Switzerland, as I noticed. And the fun part about that is always the same motherboard. So once you figured out how this one within this tablet works, you can actually hack any of the other motherboards. And I successfully booted the KDE, so full functional GNU Linux on it. That gives you the kick. I mean, a fully functional KDE. I just keep that one because that's way too technical for technical people. If someone of you is into hardware hacking and wants to learn how to do serious hardware hacking, so wants to get into microelectronic stuff, not for lecture purposes or because he wants credits or because he's doing electrical engineering studies, but because he's interested, I'd say coming into the hackerspace doing a Sunxi hacking session would be the best way to do, because it's the it's as cheap as the Raspberry Pi, but the Raspberry Pi is I don't know. a snail compared to an A20. That's why I stuck with this guys, not with Raspberry. It's the same price, but it's world support. So if you want to have Linux kernel hacking for grown-ups with the same price, come over to the hackerspace. I have some QBs around, so we can solder some customized hardware. Because we still have some issues, and I could really use some newcomer Linux kernel hackers in our SUNC team. For example, we have still SPI issues, the OHCI, USB is doing some, giving some problems. We have, it's a little bit outdated. We have the gigabit Ethernet on the A80 is a little bit wibbly bubbly, timey wimey, kind of unstable. We have I2C. I think this one works now. GPIO has been committed too. UART is working as well. I just used it for debugging recently. Come over and we check out what's not working yet by just booting a Linux xkernel and trying out features. What we are still waiting for is an A80 graphics driver, which is open source. Maybe I first have to let myself being enslaved by some by these weird people doing this Power VR chip in order to get hands onto the specifications in order to write open source driver. I don't know, because Hansi Goethe promised. Luc Verhagen promised a graphic driver, but it didn't deliver in time as he promised. Yes, exactly here. We need you. SUNC needs you. We still have issues with the KKMS driver, with the VPU, with GD2, with PS2. With many hardware interfaces, and it doesn't matter if you're a newcomer or anyone. As long as you have basic knowledge of C, that I think having hardware hacking as a main entrance sounds a little bit crazy, but that's how I learned how to code C as a child. It was like with a graphics driver on OpenBSD. But I think having something giving you direct response to your code, like making LEDs glow, lights glow up. If you write something into a register, lights glow up. Whoa, I caused a reaction. I think that's the perfect start for a newcomer to learn how to program. So, and I think instead of doing LEB, exercises in the university, doing something which actually helps a project while learning something. It's really something which should motivate anyone who's interested to learn, instead of thinking, oh wait, I can't do it because I'm a biologist and I can't immatriculate myself over there at the ETH set. Who cares? There's a hackerspace over there who are guys who don't pay you, asking for fees, just come over, let's have a mate and hack some C code. I think that's something really. And after a while, you will look into such diagrams and you will just understand them perfectly. It's trivial. After a while, it's just here. Interfaces, you have some graphics coming out, some audio stuff, a motor, SD cards, you know SD cards, everyone knows SD cards. This is a little fancy stuff you put into a smartphone, which gives you more memory. You have power, a battery symbol, AC line, watch, you look into such a diagram and you will just say, oh, obviously it's all clear what's written there. It's not that, and you don't have to go immatriculate into any university, you just go to a hackerspace like ours, sit down, have a multi and hack till you know stuff like that. Anything unclear about this diagram? Diagram. I mean, if something is unclear, come into the hackerspace and ask me. Well, let's keep that because it's not true anymore. Now I can know how to read Chinese. Okay. Yes. Let's just. That was for the closing. I just say at this point, instead of this phrase, if anyone was able to follow to this step, these chaotic phrases I just made up right in the second I say them. If you're interested in learning how to write Linux kernel drivers or something like that, because that's actually what I'm doing most of the time when I'm just not trying not to die from my cold. If you're interested in learning the Linux kernel drivers as well, because it's really fun, just have stick your head into our hackerspace, ask me stuff. I can give you some entry into this topic. We can tackle tasks. You have a device which doesn't work. We can try to figure out how to make it work on the Linux. that's actually what we are doing. That's actually what all the hacking is about. Trying to do something creative with technology. If you have a each time I had this interesting email conversation with Asus. Because I received this Transformer Prime, and they told me, well, we can't give you the encryption key for the bootloader. We can't ensure that you're satisfied with our product if you're able to decipher our bootloader. I'm not satisfied with any product if I'm not allowed to boot any software I want on the device. They were like, okay, should we just reject his insurance just for this announcement, but they were just like, okay, we can't give you the right to boot Linux kernel, any random Linux kernel on our device. So we were in this group, and there was this crypto specialist, and he cracked their crypto code with which they had secured the bootloader within a month or something. Then we were able to boot Linux Next on this device. And that's how that stuff works. We're just like, I wanna do anything. I have hardware in my hands, and I want to do anything I could imagine with this hardware. And then you start trying, and you don't give up, and you just keep on working. And each time you accomplish some new task, it gives you the total kick. And at first, it's just like a learning curve, and you might get demotivated. But result after result, it's more addictive, and it's getting more addictive. That's what hacking all about. It's more like, I wanna have more of these kicks of having accomplished something no one else has done so far at home, as Carol usually does. Where is Carol? There's Carol. Carol also has these kicks at home where he accomplishes something no one else has done at home, like his peptides. That's hacking. That's hacking. That's why I'm so fan of these all-in-the boards, because they for $50 you can just you buy something for no money, and you can just build up your desktop PC, put up a whole bunch of devices onto it, solder crazy new devices together, and you have a high-power PC with customized peripheral devices around for $100 at the end, but it's crazy. And the learning curve for newcomers is like exponential. So I think it's the best platform to show you what kick I have each time I write a new piece of code, which is doing incredible stuff. And
okay, I think it's. I think. Yeah, and thanks also to Carl from before.
This thing doesn't want to get off of my. How do
Perhaps we want
I'm
to.
I'm a nerd, I'm not capable of living in the real world. How do I.
What the fuck? I think you will survive it, yeah. Okay. You can also put the questions in German if you want. We just switched to English initially because it is being, a video podcast is being created, and we thought probably this is of international interest or something, what's being told here. But if you happen to ask in German because you don't want to ask in English, it's also fine. And we can discuss some of the projects in more detail. I think Carl said before he could show something. He could show his cleaner there in more detail if you want. But if you have questions about cultural aspects of hacking or ethical aspects, so we can also discuss this kind of stuff. So it's open for everything. Software things, hardware, ethical, political stuff, everything. So. Is there something? Someone?
Maybe someone wants to send us an email. Maybe.
Yeah. And in any case, if you want to learn different stuff that you saw here, or if you want to talk about the people, you can always just contact them or come or in case of the Chaos Computer Club, you can just come over to our hackerspace. It's at Röschibachstraße 26 near Hartbergen. So we are always there on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. But yeah, if there are if you have other ideas of other dates we could introduce for hardware hacking sessions or software hacking sessions or whatever, it's always open for it.
And I have a blog.
Oh, yeah. Wait.
No, I don't need the microphone.
Hello.
But. Wait, can you repeat, because it is being recorded, and if you don't talk into the microphone it cannot be heard.
Okay. Hello. I just want to ask if you ever had a problem because of this hacking, maybe use of some components are not free or so.
Do you mean like a technical problem or like a legal problem?
For example, the hardware, you use some stuff from other parts or so.
You mean like political or licensing problems, like licensing problems?
Licensing problems. Yeah, there was actually this time where I tried to write the ALSA driver, a sound driver for Qualcomm, and I reverse engineered how badly it was engineered. Each of these chips of Qualcomm, it's a wonder these awfully designed chips haven't put up. I was like asked nicely to take some of this stuff off the web because it was confidential. But in turn, I got free beer more than I could drink at the Fosdem, so it was worth it, the stress with Qualcomm. But yeah, I I really was emailed by a lawyer. And the fun thing about that is, figure how, imagine they, what they did was they printed out the standard formula, scribed it, scanned it in, and sent it me over as a PDF. So like, formal request to take take offline this reverse engineering documents and so on and so on. Printed out standard formula, subscribed by the lawyer, and scanned in and mailed to me as a PDF. It was like, okay, the internet reprinters. But yeah, that's a funny thing would have been if I had printed it out and folded, have put it into a folder, but I didn't. Yeah, I had.
Probably Carol has something in this sense.
Yeah, I had basically, I would say, massive technical problem because of the licensing, because as you saw, the electronics is built of simple components, a large amount of simple components. And the industry standard, usually how to do this is use a bigger intelligent component, which you can program. But all the components on the market have proprietary programming. That means the company will not tell you how to use the component. They will keep it secret, and this is their business model based on that secret. So if they tell me how to use the component, they will lose their money. So they will never do it. It's highly secret, highly proprietary licensed. And for how can the people use the component? They use a proprietary licensed program from the company, which the company has full control over, which means I cannot fit it into the open source model, into the user control, because the company can, at the marketing department, any moment can say, hey, this component, we don't need to care about anymore. We will now up business opportunities somewhere else. We just scrap it. We can take it offline, the program, and the development would stop. The user will not be able to do even minor changes anymore. So this was unfortunately a no-go for me, you know. So I can't find a part which would allow this model. So I need to use a simple component. So you know, answer to your question is yes, in my case, it has a huge technical impact, this kind of question, this licensing question, yes.
You are re-engineering these components.
No, I'm not in re-engineering. I deliberately select components which I don't need to reverse. You mean reverse engineering?
Reverse engineering.
I deliberately select components which I don't have to reverse engineer, where the manufacturer official tells you how to use it. You know, example with a car. You know, imagine you buy a car, but inside is not the usual steering wheel. It's something very extremely complicated, which you have no idea how to use. Mm-hmm. But the company can rent you a certified driver, which knows how to use this very complicated model of car. So every time you want to go to a grocery store, you have to pay this certified driver. You know, and anytime they can say, okay, but this model of car is not interesting for us anymore. We don't offer this service anymore, you know. So, you know, you see, you're not in real ownership of your car, you know. So I would not be really in ownership of the chip on the board, you know. So I don't like this kind of components which I have to reverse engineer. It's often problem with the drivers, you said, right?
Yeah, yes. It's like their documentation, especially NVIDIA. I don't quote Torvalds now, but the hardware suppliers oftenly. I think we all know what we were all talking about. The F words NVIDIA quote of Thomas, but yes, maybe.
My first time. Of course, I was nervous.
I think I was 16.
Yeah.
And I'm very, very happy to say that it's the exception rather than the rule. And I'm also happy to very publicly point out that NVIDIA has been one of the worst trouble spots we've had with hardware manufacturers. And that is really sad because NVIDIA tries to sell chips, a lot of chips, into the Android market. And NVIDIA has been the single worst company we've ever dealt with. So NVIDIA, fuck you.
Making some friends there.
I can only add to this. Oh yeah. NVIDIA has this wonderful politics, like this. Maybe you know this. I see this movie series which go on episode season by season. You always hope, yeah, we go get to a point, and then oh no, it was like NVIDIA's Tigra series, like Tigra 1. It was like. I was getting hands on the first release of Tegra 1. It was like, okay, who did that? I hope this engineer is already boiling in hell for that design. They noticed it as well and stamped it in. There was Tegra 2. It was even worse. There was this wonderful constellation where you didn't compensate the capacitors right, where if it's getting too warm and you use certain memory addresses, so you have 2 GB of RAM, but you can also only use 1 GB, because if you use the wrong addresses, it will just stick on ones at some bits. So it was like jumping into digital nirvana, crashing like hell if you try to start it up outside of a fridge. So there was release 3, which had still some proprietary graphics chip. So we were like, when we finally managed to reverse engineer the graphics chip and write the open source driver, and we just said, okay, well, you managed to reverse engineer our driver, our chip. So we give you the documentation. We were, well, we can just finalize the graphics driver because they gave us the documentation. Tegra 4, totally new graphics chip. It's like always, yay, you bastards! Yay, you bastards! And that's how these proprietary chip suppliers work. That's something you have to get used to. And it heavily depends on the recent manager of the certain chip factory. So Intel now is turning a little bit bitchy as well again. So let's hope this one manager dies soon, then we get a new one. Maybe it's going to be better again. But it's really like that. So like, okay, could someone... Hey, that's an India Go-Go, please. So we need 20K for getting... causing a new manager at Intel. So open source community project funding, I don't think it will be on for long, but it's unfortunately really working like that. You have a manager, the management decisions go like hell. You have a new manager, they turn open again. It's really, and we as an open source community are suffering, then we are like, yay, then we're suffering again, then yay. And it's really hard to find a chip producer like Xilinx, which takes care to its community, or really care about its community. Evan Foundson sends mobile free boards. It's really like a luck part. Does the manager live long enough to find the follower who does the same thing as he did? It's really like that. It's people bound. Yeah.
I still have one answer now. I remember you were talking about licensing problems, right? When I made this document about Instant Cooker, there you have, of course, pictures of the objects you have to buy in a normal shop to construct the Instant Cooker. And I used photos from the internet. And I'm used from Czech Republic. The law in Czech Republic is you allowed to kind of cite even a proprietary picture, you know, like a scientific citation, you know. It's kind of like a quotation, you know, quoting a picture. In that case, you have to write source of the picture, you know. But I realized in Switzerland this is not allowed. And some lady who was running a web shop with instruments like violins, guitars, she used a picture of a violin this way just to illustrate the what kind of stuff she's selling, you know. And she had to pay 15,000 francs a fine. So I realized now I have to change this picture into probably a line drawing, you know, something where I don't actually use the proprietary picture, you know. So it's a nuisance. And as you ask about the reverse engineering of components, I have to go down in the level of complexity of the component until the components start to be publicly described by the manufacturer, until they stop making secrets. I can say it has a positive beneficial side effect that such components are simple and therefore reliable, because they don't have the component doesn't have the necessary intelligence to be unreliable. It doesn't have the necessary intelligence to go nuts. What you often have a problem in electronics. A typical solution for maybe 80% electronics is you put a microprocessor inside, which is basically a tiny computer. But the problem is, if, for example, you have lightning strike into the house and the lightning strike causes electrical impulse, which exceeds the capabilities of the microprocessor, and some bits, zeros and one, get flipped inside the microprocessor. And the microprocessor basically gets into a random undefined state. And the device stops working. The same is with software bugs. The software bugs can bring it into undefined state. And you probably know it from many cases. You have home routers which just stop working. And you have to plug them out, plug them in. You know, it doesn't matter if the router goes crazy from a lightning strike impulse or if it goes crazy from software bugs. It's a general problem. The things have basically low MTTF, mean time between mean time MTBF. I'm not sure about the terminology, but there is a Terminus technicus which says how long does it on average takes for the device to go into non-functional state, which needs intervention of the operator. You know, your laptop maybe freezes up, crashes, you have to reboot, you know, this is a failure, you know. For consumer electronics, it's no problem. If this computer freezes, I just plug it out, no problem. But if I have this communication device, I have it on the roof, which is difficult to access, you have minus 20 degrees winter, you have heavy snowstorm, it's dark, you're risking your life on the roof, you know, you can't go there because it would be dangerous. You know, and if it starts to be unreliable, if it locks up, this is a huge nuisance. It's a very huge problem. So this device has to be really reliable. You have to mount it, and it has to run for years, you know, because it's this kind of device which is meant for outdoor installation. You know, this is some kind of, I would say, lower level requirement of electronics. So I was forced to use transistors, which are very, very simple devices, logical gates, which implement only very simple logical functions, and the, you know.
Each option or chain
Each option or field effect?
Well, I use both, but I think it's just a technical question. You know, he is working with very sophisticated chips, and you know, they have millions or billions transistor inside, and the company will probably make a mistake somewhere. So it's a big problem, and a side effect of how I was forced to lower the complexity is that I don't get this level of complexity, so the reliability is going up, and the thing gets elegant. You know, it is like robust, solid. I have a feeling I have complete control over the reliability of the thing. A negative effect is, of course, you have to solder large amount of components.
I have something else. I mean, besides licensing problems, there might also be problems with political impact or on society. I mean, the CCC showed several times that, for example, voting machines are not very secure in Germany or in the Netherlands, or also with these Trojan horses that were used in Germany, they showed that they can do more than they are allowed by law and such stuff, and this can have very serious implications for single people. So it's of course an advantage if you can say the CCC did it. That's basically also the main reason why the CCC was founded in the 1980s, because there were lots of hacking in the sense of going into computers and stuff being done. That's not the hacking we propagated today, but it can also be a form of it. But and in these times it was really necessary to protect the people of the club, and so this association was built to protect them. So you can always say the CCC is involved in this, and you can protect your members if necessary. Okay.
I guess these hacks are just a side effect. I mean, it's just you play around with hardware. You try out how far can I go. I mean, whoa, nice, there's a nice voting machine. Let's figure out how I can run my own software on it. Is it possible? Well, nice little protection. Let's try work around it. Oh, it's possible. Hey, wow, I can play Tetris on it. Or chess. And that's how it works out. And then the next step, you have politicians going haywire, like, oh my god, they just hacked our voting machines, we're doomed. And that's just a side effect. It's just a side effect from playing around with hardware.
I think there's a question here.
A question for Karel. I work in electronics, and I've seen your 3D soldering technique, which is quite fascinating, but I'm wondering how well is this working out in practice? Like, I couldn't imagine building this or debugging this. Just because parts are unreachable by a soldering iron, for example.
You mean in development or building for the user?
Both sound or look difficult to me.
Yeah, I think it makes this difficult impression, and people said, basically, several people said in these user testimonials, I don't know if I can find it now, that it looks difficult at the first sight, but when they actually do it, they're surprised how easy it is, and eventually they even report some kind of almost like nirvana feeling when it starts working. So they said it is actually much easier than it looks. Where is this? I don't know, having fun or something like that. What was it? It's somewhere here in the potential benefits and applications. I can't find it now. So I would say the development was very difficult, and it's difficult in the sense that it's unpredictable, you know, because making Quare Factory, you basically go to a university, they tell you the routine way how to design stuff. They give you a paper for that. You apply with this paper for a occupation, for a job. You get a job, and you just do the way you were told in the university, you know. And it's easy because you have huge, expensive machines which can do wonders, you know. Okay, I want this. Okay, let's do this wonder and that wonder and that wonder, you know. But, no, I'm building a household technology, basically. You know, when I'm drilling these huge holes, you know. This is 25 millimeters thick. Is 10.5 millimeters diameter, and when you drill it at home, you have you get a ball of steel wool which is as big as a tennis ball, you know, and this may be a problem because For example, I was doing it in the cellar, you know. Most houses have a cellar, which is less problem for the mess, you know. So if you play with this stuff on a floor, you can scratch the floor of your, you know. You definitely don't do this in bedroom, you know. And, you know, it's a practical, down-to-earth stuff like this, which is deciding the development. And if you realize you have some kind of problem, you, in the worst case, you may be required to redesign whole pieces, whole parts of the thing from scratch, because you realize you hit some kind of a no-no, some kind of roadblock, you know. So it's very kind of, unpredictable, the development. But the building is the opposite. It's easy.
Okay, are there other inputs, something?
Do you maybe have some curious questions about particular properties of the products? Something you didn't understand? Something from, maybe from the printed materials I sent?
Do you want to show something still?
I wanted to actually demonstrate the Plink products in use, you know, because we have a washing basin here, you know, so I can just use it. I brought a piece of rag, you know. So I don't know, Nani, how do we do it? Should the people come here, watch it, or?
If they want, they are free to do so.
Because we can't have it on the camera, you know, so it should make the thing shiny. I would like to comment it so we have it at least on the stream in audio, you know. So, you know, it make look simple. Okay, so can you come please if you're interested? You know, it may look simple, you know, so such a simple cleaning fluid, you know. But you know, you should also use it according to the instructions. These instructions are actually important for the proper operation of the product, because the instruction says somewhere you should do it twice, you know. You should basically wet the, you know, so where is the usage? Soak, dry, or run clothes. Okay, so this is a cloth. It's obviously dry, so it's okay. Or sponge with Plink. Okay, so we take the Plink. Hey, Anani, can you please hold me the mic for me? Because I need to work with both hands. Okay, so it's now it's soaked, you know, so what should we do next? Scrub the whole cleaned item. Okay, so the whole cleaned item will be the washing basin, you know, and the tap, you know. So we scrub, this is scrub, okay, I guess this is scrub. That tap has to be scrubbed, okay. And this is my idea of productization, you know, like a clear instructions I don't have.
So wait, there's even an algorithm how you should clean or what?
Yeah, there's an algorithm, and I think you get this algorithm on the normal product too, on a shampoo, you know, it says put one, rinse, whatever, repeat, you know. So, what's next? So we just scrubbed. Scrub the whole clean white item. Wipe the item again. And now is the important part, you know, because the thing contains acid, and this kind of smudges, you know, which make the part look ugly after some time. It's some kind of limestone, you know, and the acid is actually eating the limestone away, so it needs some time to actually eat through the matter, you know. And this is why we do it twice, because the second time, you know, you basically kind of mechanically move this stuff, you know, kind of wipe the half eaten stuff away, you know, you add more fresh acid, you know, whatever, how it's supposed to work. Okay, so we did it second time. What does it say now? Item again, rinse with water. Okay, so we have to rinse with water. I have to basically clean the rag, you know, soak it with fresh water, because I can't rinse, you know, with, if I'm cleaning my bathtub, I have a shower, so I can just shower the bathtub. Here I can't do it, so I use a rag to kind of wipe it with fresh water, you know. It's still having some foam, so I rinse more. And after I rinse, I watch what the instructions are saying. It's the next step. You know, so now I'm noticing it's getting pretty shiny, almost like a mirror.
Mm-hmm. I think you could get a job here at university.
And so just a tiny bit should be clean. Yeah, maybe I could work as a cleaner of the toilets, right? With open source technology. Okay, so this operation was finished. Rinse it water. Okay, and that's all. And it says if pink stops foaming, pour more into the cloth. That didn't happen. Finish cleaning of mirrors and windows. This is not a mirror of windows. So blah blah blah. For thick scales deposit, we didn't have thick scales deposit. Blah blah blah. Okay, so it's all, you know. So now I guess we have just used the product successfully, and I would say, I don't know.
It's okay. Yeah. Okay. Are there still questions or? Otherwise, the next Chaos seminar will be on December 11. It will be about copyright stuff. August 12. That's something specific to Switzerland that they want to, forbid downloads. I mean, at least the US is trying to influence our country to forbid downloads of copyrighted material. And besides of that, there are also plans of copyright holders in Switzerland that are organized in different organizations that try to somehow introduce measures to block sites and stuff. And what we do here is, I mean, this will be really in German then, because we invited several people here. Someone from the University of Zurich, Professor Dr. Monika Domann, then also probably well known in, at least in some nerdy or hacker scenes, Freddy Künstler from Init7, that's a provider, and that's a provider that is really against any form of censor and everything. So he always tries also politically to be against such measures, and so he will be more representing the technical part of this discussion and saying that it doesn't want to be part of a system where stuff is being blocked because of copyright issues. And then from the people which represent the copyright holders, we have Hans Leubli from Swiss Culture and Christoph Trummer from Musikschaffende Schweiz, is also a musician. And we have also Hardwig Thomas from the Digitale Allmend, Digitale Gesellschaft. The Digitale Allmend is responsible for the creation of Creative Commons licenses, which Karel also mentioned that he uses them for his projects. You can use Creative Commons licenses for software, for text, for hardware, for everything. And so someone from these free culture areas, let's say, will also be here. And we from the CCC will be more mediating a little bit around this stuff. So we could, we have a clear position. We are also against these measures. But there were some people here that will be on this podium saying it would be cool if also the people that are for these hard measures would be represented. And so we are giving them a platform for it. And I think it will be interesting. And we'll do it in a way that first there will be two input kind of small lectures like today, but a little bit not so long and not so technical probably. And one of these lectures will be about saying why it is necessary to enforce copyright laws in Switzerland, and the other one will be about why it is not necessary. So the first one will be from Christoph Trummer from Musikschaffende Schweiz, and the other one from
from Hartwig Thomas being against it, and then we will open up a podium here, or a panel, as you can also say, and in the end we will have enough time for discussion. We will have a look. We will ensure that we can discuss at least for 1 hour or something, because at this university there are lots of panels, but most of the time you just have 5, 10, or 15 minutes to ask something or to participate in the discussions, and we want to turn this a little bit around, that the people that are around have also a chance to say something, and yeah, I think there will be quite some people around, so. So if there are no other questions, we could close this chaos seminar for today. So thanks a lot.